This is the full mental health guide that has everything you need to fix your life. And even if you're well off in a way, this is going to benefit you a lot. Since you're watching this video and are willing to change, you're going to make mental health the biggest priority in your life. First, we have to define mental health, and mental health is literally just the health of your mental state, and it determines your experience of life, your sensations, and your thoughts. Mental health is the foundation for life, and without good mental health, you can't do hard work or hard tasks. Basically, everything will improve when you start to focus on your brain. When you have good mental health, you found yourself randomly smiling throughout the day, and you're able to stay still in one place for as long as you can. You wouldn't be bombarded by any negative thoughts or not even any thought because you're so mindful. But in today's world, there is many factors and many environmental changes that makes us have bad mental health. And you see a lot of it for the way that we treat ourselves. A lot of people just live mindlessly throughout life without ever being present. They go to work that they don't enjoy and they sleep late. They're consumed by the internet and eat very awful food. You might have things in your life that bother you in terms of how you are. This means that you procrastinate, you sleep late, you have insecurities, you have a poor diet, a lack of motivation. Basically, all of these are symptoms of bad mental health. So you have to understand that the reasons why we have poor diets or that we don't feel like doing the work is because we have bad mental health. That's why most depressed people just live very awfully and lie in their bed all the time. It's super hard for them to do tasks like brushing their teeth. And this is all because they lowered their mental health throughout time. As soon as you improve your mental health with the practices I'm going to show you, you will feel better. There is definitely a way to live which is much healthier than what you currently are living. Maybe you always wanted something that you like. Like you always wanted to make a business and make money. Or you always wanted that six-pack to get impressions from the girls on the beach. Anything that takes time and dedication is much easier with mental health. You want to be super social. You want to be fit. You want that car, that girl, them friends. You want all of these things. If so, you have to improve your mental health. The way you improve your mental health is by starting to live with habits that you do every day. They might be hard to do right now, but it is going to be much beneficial later down the road. The way to improve mental health is simply by living a life where you have the habits that you do every day. They might be hard, but they'll be immensely beneficial later down the road. So that is things like exercise, meditation, gratitude journaling, speaking to your friends, going out, getting some sunlight, getting good sleep, and so on. I'm going to ask you a question. Are you as good as you could be? Do this right now. Think about how much you could ever do in your day-to-day life. You're at your fullest potential, and your life is fully aligned with your goals and purpose. You're using 100% of your capacity. Compared to what you could be doing in life, with what amount of efficiency are you living? Let's say that you're performing at 50% of your capabilities. With the state of your mind, you can work at 50% efficiency right now. But if you improve your mental health, you can go up to 60, then 70, then 80, all the way up to 100. If you doubt yourself about reaching your highest potential, know that it's your weak and frail voice in your mind speaking. If you truly want to reach your fullest potential, you have to improve your mental space. Don't be fine with just 50% efficiency. You know that you want to reach more in this life. So the first skill you must level up is taking action. This is the skill of being able to start anything, ranging from making your bed, all the way to making the biggest decisions of your life that will change your course. You will highly increase that skill of taking action when you take action for the things in your life, even when you don't feel like it. I don't feel like getting out of bed. I don't feel like going to school. I don't feel like doing this and that. Just shut the fuck up and do it. Listening to your emotions has led you to negative outcomes, so do the work. Now, that's some good advice if your mental health is already well off, but if you're down bad, you can start with the smallest tasks. Eventually, you'll make more decisions and be more decisive as a person. And eventually, you're going to take action on changing your life. For every action in your life, you have to know what the consequences are and what you're doing them for. This is coupled by taking responsibility. When you become responsible, you're more capable and needed in this world. Everything that occurs in your life, you are 100% responsible for it. You're responsible for how people react to you, how you go through your day, how you handle your emotions and actions. You're responsible for everything. Of course, there's some things that are totally out of your reach, but take as much responsibility as you can from your surroundings. There's many ways to do that, like being the leader of a group project. With this, you increase your masculine problem solving and your competence. We don't always get the opportunity to become responsible when we're young because of our parents and our schools, but it's exactly the moment when you become needed and capable that you become a responsible person. It makes you feel good. You're useful in this world. You're needed. So take action and responsibility for what happens in your life and take action on self-improvement. You've got the basic understandings of how your mind works and how to start things. This is going to seem so below you and your ego is going to pipe up. But what I'm about to tell you, you must do it for at least a week. This chapter is titled, Set the Bar Low. This means that you have to do the bare minimum for the good habits. You have the capacity to do a lot, but your mental space is not strong enough to handle that over time. We have to start lower and closer to our level. Since we are starting in this journey and want to get the victories, we have to first get the small achievable wins. Starting at the bare minimum might seem so under you, but remember that you have your entire life to do self-improvement. The point of starting so low is simply to just increase your consistency skill. Consistency skill. I don't like that word. It'll be easy to do one push-up right now, right? If you do that every day, you will inevitably increase the skill of consistency. Let's say that the most push-ups you can do right now is 10. If you do 10 every day, inevitably you're going to get strong enough to do 20, then 30, then 50. You increase your level of strength and relative strength, and you continue over the weeks to work out more. You make sessions of 5 minutes, then 10, then 20. You learn more about working out, and inevitably, one day, you will become so consistent that you will not even think about working out. And because you are consistent in working out, you have a muscular and lean body. Your schedule looks like this. 2 hours of working out, 6 times per week. And it's all thanks to your dedication and progress in the leveling up of consistency, and then you increase the intensity later. This levels up the skill of taking action. This whole workout journey would never be possible if you only focused on intensity. It is utterly useless to work on intensity when you don't even have consistency. So start at the lowest bar, at the lowest amount of effort, but keep the consistency. When your level is high enough that you're actually over the level that you're currently at, you can increase the intensity. Let's imagine a beginner that doesn't know about consistency and he begins meditating. He'll try to meditate every day for an hour, and on the third day, he's just going to feel burned out and feel tired. He's going to complain about not being able to clear his mind. Of course, you're not going to clear your mind on your third day, no matter the intensity. Now you understand that when you start with any journey, consistency is over intensity. Another way to do that is just by showing up. In a habit, it's more important to do the many steps of your habits. For example, when you go to the gym, you have to dress up, you have to prepare the water, you have to prepare your shoes, you have to go to the gym itself. These are all many steps that you need. This process is important to master, and you have to get consistent in that also. Because if you don't prepare for something properly, you are going to miss out on the benefits of doing it fully and with all the benefits. Basically, it doesn't become as efficient. Anyways, I'm going to talk about the habits that improve your mental health. Meditation, gratitude journaling, and exercise. These are the three habits you are going to level up across your self-improvement journey, and they will give you the biggest startup. We'll start off with meditation. Meditation is the practice, and what you gain from it is mindfulness. And I'm going to explain your meditation in a simple way that you can actually do any time of your day. This is a four-step process. And when you meditate, you have an anchor. And an anchor is the point on what you focus on. So for example, when you meditate, that is mostly breathing. I'm going to show you on the screen right now what the four cycles are. We start off being present in the moment. This is the time where we're actually mindful and we held our focus on our anchor point. And from being mindful in the present moment, you go to mind wandering. And mind wandering is when you lose your focus and you get deep into thought. After that, we have the realization of not being conscious or not being mindful. And after that process, we bring back our focus on the present moment. When you go from bringing your focus back and going to your mindful state, this is where you get the repetition. The repetition is basically like one push-up or one squat. It's like training your mindfulness and imagining that your mindfulness is a physique. The stronger your mindfulness is, the more it looks like a giga chad. So the more cycles you'll go through, the more you're going to become mindful, or at least make it easier to become mindful. And mindfulness is a valuable trait within humans. It makes us aware and conscious about the present moment. Being mindful, in my experience, is one of the most beautiful things that you could ever live. It lets you really see the world for what it is, and it gives you total focus. The opposite of mindfulness is mind wandering. And mind wandering is when you're going deep into your thoughts and getting away from life. Basically, you don't know what's happening and you're just thinking. When you mind wander a lot, it's probably because you just have an excess of internet usage, mostly social media. On social media, we tend to be exposed to an algorithm of content in which information comes every second, and that's too much for the brain. We were never supposed to hold in so much information at the same time. So what does the mind do? Since it's super adaptive and can change to anything, including what it's being shown, it is going to be more like these algorithms. The mind is constantly thinking about random stuff as if it is scrolling on YouTube. When you develop your mind wandering, you're just making it easier for your brain to scroll in your mind. We all know that scrolling doesn't really benefit us in a way. It just gives us a laugh every 5 minutes. You're scrolling on your phone, and you're just silent. You stare as if you're dead, and you might chuckle when you see a meme. With mindfulness, you're going to decrease your mind wandering by leveling up the skill of how quickly you realize you are into thoughts and bring yourself back to the present moment. This is one of the biggest things you need in life if you want to increase your mental health. This is seriously one of the biggest practices you have to do in your life if you want to be mentally healthy. Mindfulness will cure anxiety. All right, do this with me. Take a deep breath in. In 3, 2, 1. Were you mindful? Next up, we've got gratitude. Gratitude is the skill of being grateful and thankful for the things that you have in life. It makes the thoughts in your mind also more positive. And as counterintuitive as it sounds, when you become really grateful with a lot of gratitude journaling, you are going to be grateful for the bad things about you, about the moments that happened to you and what you complain about. You'll be grateful for them. All of the hate and the bad things that happened to you, the abuse and the resentment that you lived, will all go away once you become grateful. And like I said, this takes a lot of gratitude journaling. Now, gratitude journaling is the practice of being grateful. You basically just take a book, like I did with this one, and you write things that you're grateful for. It's much more powerful to use books than to just think it, because in books, you have the written thoughts. And when you do write about what you're grateful for, you have to realize why. Why does that thing deserve gratitude? All right, here, I'll give you an example. I am grateful for this microphone. This is a microphone that my sister bought me 2 months ago, and it's a much better microphone than the one that I had before. You can hear it in my past videos how it sounds compared to this one. And I'm really proud of it, and I even like the design. I can actually hold it well. That was an example of gratitude. And gratitude is a scientific way to become happy, because you increase the likelihood of getting more positive thoughts than negative ones. Imagine seeing everything in a positive and happy way. You are going to be mentally healthy if that is the case. And lastly, we've got the last important habit, which is related to your mental health. This is physical activity. There's so many studies and research that prove how physical activity can benefit you. It increases your mental well-being. It reduces the risk of death and disease. It basically makes you live longer. We all know how moving our bodies can make us feel good, because we were meant to be outside all day and just move all the time. So the main point is moving more makes you more mentally healthy. A good way to incorporate exercise in your daily routine is to find a cardiovascular habit, activity, that you can do every day. There's many ways to get your heart pumping, and these are things like running, jogging, rowing, skiing, cycling, playing basketball, and just walking, moving more. You've also got something that's called high intensity interval training. This type of training looks like a cycle of movements that you do on a set time. So you do stuff like lunges, explosive push-ups, jumping squats, on a minute by the minute. These exercises will improve the way that your heart works, and it'll just make you live longer, and you'll live happy. Yeah, I'm going to record and eat at the same time. Now, you've got 3 simple habits that you do every day. What I want you to do is get a piece of paper or take a notebook and make it about self-improvement. Once you've acquired yourself a book, you can write the 3 main habits: meditation, gratitude journaling, and exercise. And make a simple table for this week. On the left, you write the 3 main habits, and on top, you write the days. So I'll show you what that looks like. Alright, this is a habit tracker. Every day, you're tasked with doing the minimum amount of effort for each of these. So for meditation, you take a minute to become mindful, Write a small paragraph about what you're grateful for, and choose one exercise that will get your blood circulating. You'll track your progress with this handy habit tracker, and you will follow through. If you want to start doing bigger things in your life, you have to start, first of all, with this. So that's the thing that I talked about when I mentioned setting the bar low. You have to put consistency and then intensity. In fact, I want you to be obsessed with this. When you fulfill a whole week of progress, just look at it and be proud of how much progress you've made. This habit tracker would be amazing if you completed it for a whole year. And what you see on the wall is a habit tracker for my entire year. I already have a quarter of the year and I made so much progress. And also for the three main habits. So for example, you have meditation. I want you to write the level of what that meditation is. So for example, level one is literally just one mindful breath. And for the next week or next level is going to be 1 minute of meditation, then two, three, four, five, and so on. This is to also track your progress because you might not really remember what level you were at a given week. And of course, you can keep this habit tracker for much more than a week. And after you're done with the challenge that I just gave you, you can raise the bar later. So that can be level three for each of the habits. Meaning that for meditation, you go from one mindful breath to 5 minutes of meditation. For gratitude journaling, you do from one paragraph to a whole page. And for exercise, you go from 10 push-ups to a 20-minute workout. You keep your consistency with this habit tracker, and it's really a handy tool. I really recommend it. These three habits give immense benefits, and I'm going to make more videos about them soon. And if you want these benefits for life, well, you gotta keep doing the habits for life. These habits will be literally just like breathing, sleeping, eating. They're automatic and mandatory. Imagine just meditating and thinking to yourself that it's like drinking water. It's just that important. And with a plan, you must have a clear objective. You want to become mentally healthy, right? You're watching this video and I gave you already a lot of information you can take in. But I'm going to remind you, are you willing to go through this? Because if you're watching this video for simply just entertainment and not education, then you're better off clicking off this video. But if you watch with a sense of wanting to learn, then that is the correct approach of watching videos. Next up, we have learning. There's a saying that I like, which is knowing is half the battle. The more you know about a given situation, the more you're likely to navigate through it efficiently. Before I get into this, I want to make a quick note for the people who don't like school and hate learning because of that. I used to be like that. When I was in school, I was always just bored of how slow the information came in and I didn't see the point of learning for school or following a brain-numbing schedule for 8 hours a day. School makes a lot of kids hate learning, and it's sad to see. So I want to clarify that learning in school is different than making your own research and using your own curiosity to find what you want. Anyways, learning is a skill in which you take information and understand concepts and ideas. First, you have the topic or subject for which you're learning, and it varies depending on how interested you are and how passionate you are for them. The two ways to learn that are the most efficient are watching long-form educational content like this one and reading books with practical steps. Watching long videos that explain many concepts and ideas is super beneficial for the brain. Because staying tuned for an hour increases your attention span, your focus, and how much you can actually understand the information. As you watch more of this video, you increase the momentum of how much you understand and learn. You're more likely to understand and get knowledge when you've been learning for an hour instead of just when you started. And these types of videos have been made to be educational and are crafted in a way for you to absorb the information correctly. Of course, there's also podcasts you can listen to if you want. Long-form educational content, the opposite of that is basically TikTok, Reels, YouTube Shorts, which is the worst. You'll think that you're getting something out of it, but instead you're just resetting your focus each time you go on the next video. And any education you get from short videos like this is most likely going to be a scientific fact you're gonna forget in a day. If you think you can learn from YouTube Shorts, you're a dumbass. Let's get back to the video. The other way to learn is by reading books. Books are like long videos, but you have to put more attention and focus on each word that you're reading. And it's harder than watching a video because in a book you have to make your own talking in your head. And whilst in a video, you just hear the person talking. I haven't read many books actively to learn, but I can tell you that there's a magic within reading before going to sleep. So when can you learn? Well, you can learn in your spare time, and that includes the time that you gave yourself before going to sleep. The moments you can learn a lot is when you're doing mundane tasks. So for example, when you're organizing the folders that you have in your computer, like I used to do, or just washing the dishes. You can also be driving in a car, and if you know the road well enough, you can be driving a car and listening to a podcast. Although this does deflect mindfulness. So I have to make the choice between being mindful or taking the time to learn. Since your aim is to improve your mental health, you will learn about mental health. So when you watch these types of videos that are educational and long, you can take notes. This means that instead of just watching the video and remembering a little, you're going to write down the information, the bullet points, and the most important points for you. And from that, you're going to learn much more, since you can always read what you just wrote. Again, I'm going to mention that holding a self-improvement book is super beneficial. For example, this is my book. So what I did with a lot of videos recently is I watched long-form educational content, and what I would write about is, first of all, the chapters, the actionable steps, and the concepts and ideas to know. So I'll give you a few sources you can go to, and I'll put their links down in the description. Literally, the best self-improvement channel for men on YouTube is Hamza Ahmed. Everything I'm telling you in this video are things that I learned from him. I highly recommend you check him out, and he has a lot of videos that are long with a lot of practical steps. Then, if you want to learn about more mental health, you can check out the course, which is called The Science of Well-Being. This is an online course you can follow at any given moment. It's presented by this woman, I think her name is Lori Santos. She led an experiment with her students in the Yale University just to increase well-being. And now, it's one of the most popular classes on the internet. You can enroll in a class. From what I've seen, there is 10 weeks of requirement weeks where you have to do basic tasks every day. It's one of the most enrolled classes on Coursera.com. .org. Coursera.org. Lastly, we've got Andrew Huberman, who is a professor of neurobiology at the Stanford School of Medicine, where he discusses in his podcast about science and science-based tools for everyday life. That's the thing that he says every podcast. His videos are quite long, but they hold a lot of valuable information, and he oversimplifies scientific terms into things that the common person can understand. He's got mentions about mindfulness and gratitude, and other things like cold showering and exercise. What I have to warn you about self-improvement is that it is dangerous to get mindless and start binge-watching these videos. There's so many different advice and you feel lost as you watch different people say different things. You might find yourself a content creator which you really like and you just watch every single video that he made or she made about self-improvement just to try to find all of the answers. If you watch these videos without a clear objective and you just want to find all the answers at the same time, You are causing yourself mental masturbation. We don't want you to just move on from watching TikTok and entertainment videos to educational content, but you're still mindless and don't understand what you're learning. Not all information you learn from self-improvement videos are valuable. And there's a lot of misleading paths and mindsets that will get you away from living a fulfilling and beautiful life. So if you need to know something, instead of just watching 10 videos about it, I want you to be very careful with what you're going to watch. Make it your task to actually learn and implement the steps that you just heard. You will have the best learning experience, not only when you're going through learning, like reading books, but also when you live your life with real experiences. You'll get the best lessons when you go through situations, and you can always look back at what you did good and what you did bad. You navigate through life and study human psychology for that. And you'll learn the most, especially when you fail, because failing is a miscalculation or not knowing enough about something. And you can always self-analyze and understand how you did the mistake. And you learn how to improve yourself, for real. That's how it goes. You can only be a real success if you become a failure many times. With all of this information, you must know that education is the key to success. As soon as you switch from entertainment to education, you will get the success you always wanted. So start learning and carefully check the free recommendations that I gave you. For this chapter of the guide, we're going to talk about dopamine detox. In the past few years, dopamine detox became a trend in which you reduce the easy dopamines, which come from the instant gratification activities. So that's like scrolling on your phone. We replace these easy dopamines with the hard ones, which come from delayed gratification, the hard work that is going to benefit your future. Basically, it is the way that humans are supposed to live. We're not supposed to be distracted all the time, and we need a purpose, somewhere to go to, a direction in our lives to make us feel good. This is a dopamine molecule. The aim of a dopamine detox is to replace the circuit, the reward circuit of the bad habits to the good ones. This makes life not just healthier, but also more enjoyable. But of course, I'm going to talk about this in later videos because this is a full mental health guide and I cannot have the time to mention all of the things about dopamine detox. I'm planning to make a video on a full dopamine detox. I want to explain meditation and gratitude journaling and more of these. Because I want to make a space on YouTube where there's no confusion. I don't make 10 videos about meditation. It's just one single thing. And if you want to start self-improvement, you can watch everything that's on the YouTube channel. And when I'm done with all of the videos, you'll have everything on my YouTube channel and you won't be needing to look at other channels. Anyways, to explain instant and delayed gratification activities, I'm going to give you a graph. These are the two graphs. This is instant gratification, and this is delayed gratification. We see that on the instant gratification, we get happiness here. But since it's the bad habit, it goes down, and then it creates a new baseline. Because this is the baseline from before, and this is the new baseline of happiness when you do the bad activities. And this is also the measurement of time. When you do delayed gratification activities, you start off with your baseline here, and as you do the activity that helps you with your happiness, it goes down, because sometimes it is hard. But then, since it's a good habit, it goes up and creates a new baseline where you become happier. So the lower the baseline is, the less happy you are. You must understand that for most of your life, you've been contaminated by social media and internet. It's no surprise that most people are depressed, anxious, and not fulfilled with their lives. And one of the reasons is because of the manipulation of this reward circuit. You feel good as you're doing the easy activities, like watching porn or scrolling on your phone. But they're actually just bad. and you become truly happy in your life in the long term when you do the activities where you get the dopamines later. Remember that it takes time to reverse anything that he did for years. So for example, if you ate candy every day for 10 years, you cannot expect that you stop eating candy within a week. The simple and practical steps of doing a dopamine detox is realizing what you're addicted to. I'm certain if you're watching this video, you're addicted to the internet. I certainly am. And if you got more addictions, like binge eating or playing video games, you have a simple protocol. You just put the substance in front of you and resist. This trains willpower. And the more willpower that you have, the more likely you are to resist your temptations. The habits you've got on a dopamine detox are the following. Meditation to gain mindfulness. Gratitude journaling to become grateful. Exercise to become physically healthy. Journaling so you can once think for your life and realize what's in your thoughts, and also learning so you can gain knowledge. And of course, you're going to be doing wholesome things like going outside in the nature or talking to your family. I'll give you a much more detailed guide about how to carry a dopamine detox. There's too much to cover about this topic, and it's heavily related to self-improvement. I want to present you the correct way to carry a dopamine detox, which won't make you a dopamine detox maniac where you just stay in your room all day and do the good habits. You have to remember that you also have your life to live, not just some dopamine detox life. Your environment is an important factor to consider. What's around you and how it works determines who you are. And if you learn about your environment and your surroundings, you can decide to navigate through it in a way that benefits you. You can traverse the system to your liking. The first theme of environment is adventure. When was the last time you had a real adventure where you went somewhere and you literally just lost yourself, but you had so much fun? They procure a sense of liveliness and they relax your mind. But at the same time, you become more wary about your actions and what are you gonna do. Usually you get the most adventure from long trips. But an easier way to carry out adventure is through exploring. And exploring is finding out everything that's around you. Let's say that you live in a city. In a 1 kilometer radius, do you know every place? When you're walking down the street and you see a road that you never passed, go there. Examine what's lurking in the shadows of the world. And by world, I mean your mental map of the Earth. Yes, I said Earth. Imagine the places on Earth where you went, and these are the only places that are actually visible on the map. When you visualize this map and realize that most of the world is blacked out and dark, you see how big it is. You might be able to name every country, but you don't know how it feels like to be in each corner of the Earth. And this sense of exploration and curiosity brings the child back in you. You remember when you were a kid and you always wanted to know everything? You'd explore places and go to corners that you'd never seen and be amazed at the slightest detail that you see. Moving around your perimeter is very recommended because you appreciate life more and also you actually know about the place you're surrounded by. It's pretty odd to just live in apartments and never know what's in the streets 3 blocks away from you. I can give you some advice on my personal experience. When you do running for long distances, do it with a spirit of exploration and being a child so you can explore more. Because you're just running, which is a good activity, it pumps your heart. And you also just develop the sense of adventure that you have in you. Literally just run in the unknown. Run in places that you've never been in. And even if you stop, it's fine because you're all doing it for adventure. And still, you're gonna get the most benefits. I mean, most of the benefits from running. And if you want to apply adventure to your running, don't do it on a treadmill. You're literally staying at the same place and you're not gonna be as happy. Journaling. This is one of the most important practices in your life, And it forces your brain to think, and you'll find out about yourself when you journal a lot. Journaling is just writing down your thoughts, and the benefit of that is that you can read your thoughts whenever you want. I remember when I used to think deeply about things, I would forget about them in a week. But writing about your goals, writing about the habits that you have, what you feel, what you think, what your concepts and ideas are, your rules. You write all of these and you sharpen your mind because you clarify what you already know and you learn more about yourself. But writing down your goals, what you think about them, and exercising your brain to ask yourself hard questions sharpens your mind. And of course, journaling only counts when you read your notes again. Bro, I look retarded. The most important and influential people of history all had journals. When you think about the people who led this earth, they all had to make big decisions. And big decisions were made through thinking deeply and writing down their notes or ideas. Journaling is very powerful, and when you include meditation and gratitude journaling, you'll just have more mindful, more happy thoughts, basically. And those thoughts you'll write down on your journal. If you don't know what to write, just let your brain think. And when your brain thinks, you can write it down. I journaled a lot back in the day, and I realized that I would just think about something, and then the flow of the writing would just go by itself. If anything is bothering you, write about it. Redirect your thoughts to unraveling the reasons why you have that bother. And one of the most important journaling prompts is one that I call the health checkup. In this exercise, you simply write about your health. What are the symptoms that you're experiencing right now? Do you have any health concerns in your body? Do you sit around 10 hours per day on the chair? Do you get enough sunlight? Do you sleep well? Do you eat healthy? Once you realize what you can work on to become healthier, learn about it. Take some time from your day to learn about your health and how those symptoms work. And when you journal every few moments about your health and realize how you can improve those, the 7-year-old version of yourself will be so proud that he can still move like this. Your health might be the same as right now, and you can live longer. Live longer while being healthy. You should study all of the positive things about your health, but especially the negative sides of our society and our city environments. You should look into air pollution, waves and radiation, noise pollution, and so on. Learn about how your body works. That's basically anatomy. What are the foods that give you a full nutrition? Which exercises keep your body healthy and flexible? What are some cardiovascular moves that you can use to strengthen your heart? Literally, the more you move, the longer you live. And also, the three staples of physical health are exercise, sleep, and diet. And the way that you learn about them is to actually want to get healthier. So start learning a bit every day. You'll make the best friendships once you commit yourself to self-improvement. And when you're at a very good place within yourself, you're going to attract other people that are the same as you. Humans are social creatures, and it's very important to hold connections with other people. If you ever consider yourself as a lone wolf, you're cringe. The lone wolf dies alone. And I guarantee you that your happiest moments in your life was when you were with other people, as opposed to the saddest times in your life. That was probably when you were alone. The skill of socializing is yet another skill. It's social skills. You can learn, you can practice, you can improve that skill. And everyone has something to bring to the table, even the dumbest ones. So your practical step is to learn something from the skill branch of socializing, and you apply it to real life. A great way to take actionable steps is to read How to Win Friends and Influence People. This book gives you the most practical advice you can do, and if you're weird and awkward, following the steps in this book will help you navigate relations with people, and you'll do it with so much more direction and clear-headedness. Now, relationships seem like a complicating thing today because of all of the information there is on the internet. there's all these so-called pills in which people online indulge in. So if you take the blue pill, you prioritize women too much and you basically become a simp. If you take the red pill, then you just start to fuck bitches and make money. And if you take the black pill, which is the worst one yet, you just become nihilistic if you're really ugly, but if you're beautiful, you just get everything. Of course, that's complete bullshit, because your looks do not determine fully your attraction. These pills, I believe, they come from a missing sense of direction in young men. Out of desperation, they try to find an answer online, and they indulge in these ideas and concepts. And because there is a big demand of desperation and wanting to become better, this is where we get self-improvement. And as much as these types of videos are nice and help a lot of people, do not get consumed by it. Don't get to the point where you just watch all these videos and don't do anything with your life, not taking the actionable steps that we're getting told. This means you watch all the videos, but you don't take any action. That was just a quick side tangent. As humans, we want to be loved and we need intimacy to continue our existence for our offsprings. But it's especially hard today because in a 10-kilometer radius, we're competing with everybody. If you want a partner, go outside and pay close attention. You level up your skill in dating once you do things like going on a date or keeping up with her. Get your heart broken a couple times and learn how to deal with women. I'm fairly young, so I cannot tell you much about this. And from the little experience I have, all I can tell you is that you have to go through the discomfort of navigating social situations and meeting people. Here's a challenge for you. In the next month, I want you to meet 100 strangers. And meeting a stranger literally just entails that you go up to them, you say hi. That is the minimum. And of course, when you've done that enough times, you can just start practicing the skill of continuing a conversation. You write down your progress and list the people you meet. This will get you to strike up some conversations. And when you go do this challenge, with of course the practical steps of how to win friends and influence people, you're going to excel with your social skills. Alright, I'm done recording for today. I'm going to record later during the night. See you then. I'm back at it again. And finally, we're going to talk about purpose. Now, this is one of the most important things to figure out when you're young. This gives you a reason to live, a mission which gives your fullest gift to the world. So spend some time in your day to think about your purpose. And obviously, you can use your pen and paper or your journal. Cut down all distractions and ask yourself the real questions about what really matters. What do you care about? What are your passions? What are your talents? Find the thing that will get you out of bed every morning feeling excited to make progress in your purpose. This purpose should be something that you do every single day of your life, and regardless of the money that you make. Imagine having much more money than you could ever have. Was the work that you do forever? And also, your purpose should be something greater than you, so you can feel more needed in this world. I recommend that you spend a few days or even weeks to think about it. You go to the extreme end of finding a place that is far away from your home, your work, your past life. Leave everything temporarily and find a quiet place where you can think about your purpose. Come prepared with food and water, talk to the people that are intelligent in your life, and have zero distractions. This short period is reserved to thinking about what you did in your life and what you might deeply love. For example, my purpose in life might be to make videos since I made a lot of them. Or I might be a music man since I love music so much. But for now, I am increasing my mental and physical health as well as getting more experience in life. I'm starting to live more. Once you figure out your purpose, try out new things. See what you like in any endeavor or work. Maybe you'll find that boxing is your passion. You really like teaching things to people, or you might even become an archaeologist. To become an entrepreneur and make businesses to take care of people that you really care about. There's so many endless possibilities, and don't feel in a rush to discover your passions. You've got your whole life ahead of you. Don't take life too seriously and believe that it can do anything in this world. Well, if your mental health is poor, you probably have doubts about yourself. But this is why you watch this whole video, is to be able to become something in this life. For the last part of the video, which is the most important one, we're going to actually take action and make a plan for which we can make progress in. For the rest of your life, you're going to start doing meditation, gratitude journaling, and exercise. I'm going to show you a realistic day where you make the minimum progress in your goals, and a full-on productive day for self-improvement. For beginners, every day of this week, you are going to do the three main habits. As early as you can, do 1 minute of meditation, write a paragraph of things that you're grateful for, and do a couple minutes of exercise. Of course, if a skill is too easy for you, you can raise the bar. So for example, me, I don't need to do 5 minutes of squats because I already work out consistently. In your spare time, instead of watching entertainment content, you could watch educational content, and you have to be very careful and intentional at what you're watching. Go out of your home and get a sense of exploration, and also capture some sunlight for the vitamin D. Journal about your health, your purpose, your thoughts, your decisions, and also sleep early and wake up early. I just gave you a few points of things you can do. But to actually make progress, you need a structure. There are two ways to make a well-planned day. The first method is to make a timetable. In it, you write everything that you're going to do at the given moment. Here is an example of what a timetable could look like. We begin the day with a morning routine, so we need our morning and night routine to be as predictable as possible to retain consistency and track your progress authentically. For beginners, you can just start with your chosen exercise. After you're done with that, you go to meditation, then gratitude journaling. For the last part of the routine, you do the hardest task of the day. This is something that makes you uncomfortable, and you have to actually put time and effort in it. It can be your homework, recording a video like I'm doing now, making the work that has to be done, and not procrastinating over it. When you start the day with the hardest task, the rest of your day just seems more easy, and you don't have to think and procrastinate about it. This is the opposite of delaying the work and becoming anxious because there's that one thing that you have to do. After that, we've got going outside and exploring. We weren't born on this earth to stay in our rooms all day, so going out is important. After the next important habit is learning. You think about what you need to know in life. So if you want to learn something about exercise or working out, you want to do some research and study for plans you can start doing. And of course, make your education intake healthy and watch long-form content to not fry your dopamine receptors and learn more efficiently, as well as taking notes and reading again. Then, we've got the night routine, used to start cooling off and calming ourselves down to prepare to sleep. You can read some books, journal some thoughts down, and eventually go to sleep at 21. This was just an example of a daily timetable. What you really need is just a predictable morning routine and a predictable night routine. But for now, just start with meditating, gratitude journaling, and exercise. The other way to plan your days is to make a to-do list for tomorrow. That's what I do every day. The convenience with this one is that you can adapt to what you're going to do, and you have to think about what you're going to do. So every night before going to bed, write a to-do list for tomorrow. You can look at it here. The habits I do are still in my daily routine, but I use other methods to keep myself engaged in them. So for the habits like exercise, meditation, and gratitude journaling, I keep a habit tracker. Like I previously mentioned, I have a habit tracker on my wall. On top of the three habits that I have on my habit tracker, I also have running and cold showers. And putting it somewhere that is fully visible. gives you more accountability, and you have more desire to fulfill the boxes. This is also relevant to sticking papers on your walls about your goals and tasks. These papers are for whatever you want to accomplish, and what I want to do here is write my goals and how I get to them. Then, we've got the big plan, the practical way of making progress. We've got the big goal for you to accomplish within a long period of time, for example, a year. A simple way to find your goals that you want to achieve is to make a list. So, for example, you can make 1,000 subs or $100 per month online. You write these, and then you take what's most important from this list. Basically, you have to cross out everything that you don't want to do. You've chosen your most important thing, which is this one, and you forget about the others. Now, it's fine if you have maximum 3 things that you want to achieve, but do not have more, because more will just give you more distractions. You'll focus much better if you have 1 thing than 10 things at the same time. Now, you've got your goals, but to get to that goal, you need weekly performance tasks. How I organize this is by writing the tasks I need to complete, as well as the daily habits I follow through. Below all of this, I write my to-do list for the next day. Of course, these are all examples that you can take inspiration from, and you can always change it depending on your circumstances. There's not a one-fits-all solution to tasks and schedules. And my very last point is to take this journey very lightly. Just start building the discipline and consistency with these 3 habits. Take ideas from this long video you just watched. And very importantly, don't overdose on self-improvement content to the point that you don't take action. Focus on making the practical steps and what you want to do in life. And also, thank you for watching the video. I'm going to make more videos, but not as long as this one. And I'm going to get more into depth for the things that I talked about today. So my next videos are going to be about meditation, gratitude journaling, dopamine detox, how to break addictions, how the lizard brain works, and so on. I've got many more ideas, but I'll work on the most important ones. And finally, I hope this guide serves you well. I hope this guide serves you well. That was a pretty long process. All right, I'm going. This is something I want to get out of my chest. Even though what I'm going to talk about is not structured, it's just a rant, I recommend you to listen. If you truly want to change your life, you have to make progress. And now, I don't mean progress as in leveling up. What you have to do is something called self-destruction. Self-destruction is basically destroying the identity of yourself that you don't like. And going through self-destruction is probably one of the most uncomfortable things you will do in your life. I'm mentioning self-destruction because it's important to not get trapped in the unending cycle of self-improvement, where you learn about ideas and concepts, you try to apply it in your day-to-day life, you see minor progress and you get frustrated when you just don't get what you want. You continuously watch the self-improvement videos and always want to know more and more, instead of actually getting experience out there in the world. There's always something new you need to think of. Like a new course, a new tactic, a new mindset. But what you actually need is a simple amount of essential things. You need less. And don't make the mistake that I did when I started my self-improvement journey. I always wanted to do everything at once, and I would get frustrated when I couldn't do something right, so I'd quit or do it mindlessly. This is a mental battle to create your new self. Stop looking outwards into the world, trying to find answers constantly. We tend to forget that we've got internal intuitions and problems we have to face, demons we have to confront and fight until you conquer them. I'm not bashing self-improvement as a whole. I just don't like the sugarcoating that there is with the way people treat it. And how many men don't implement what they learn. They watch so many self-improvement videos, and all I see is their knowledge with no experience. In life, you need much more experience than knowledge about topics. Knowledge is only important when you encounter a bump in your journey and need to know how something works. Why do you think that to master a skill, you need 10,000 hours? It's because experience is the way you learn and actually remember, actually retain your knowledge. Instead of mentally masturbating yourself off to yet another 7 ways to get money or 5 things you need as a man. If you want to grow, you make the bitch in you fade away. Dissolve the beliefs you've got that are detrimental to your mental well-being and don't consume a lot of the things trying to find answers. Just take action with what you already know. That's the biggest secret to actually leveling up and taking action. Think of yourself as a tree. You've got branches and leaves that are habits and mindsets. But you've got some roots that are infected and unhealthy. Self-improvement is cutting off these old branches, but they come back when you don't change who you are internally. Self-destruction means you destroy who you are to form a new and stronger identity. We're too focused on who we are instead of who we can be. What I'm talking about here is a rapid personality change phenomenon. And this rebirth of yourself is one of the most useful and in demand for those who are truly low in life. For average people, it's a bit harder. But all you really need is solitude, meditation, writing, and action. Again, you gotta journal and be very honest to yourself. Visualize your biggest fears and misconceptions of life. And destroy yourself mentally by getting to the roots of your problems. You think about what you don't like about your life and what you actually lack. You need to be the best in everything all at the same time. But you can't. Solve one problem at a time. I wrote this guide with the aim to give you the important starting points, as well as the reminder to be mindful and careful of what you consume. The mindsets and tactics I give you in this video are simply starting points, and I don't want you to continue finding more and more. Just start with everything I mentioned in this video, and when you've went through the process for months, then you can increase your level of self-improvement. Always keep in mind that to make life-changing progress, you must destroy your old identity and create the new. All that I'm saying was inspired by the movie Fight Club. I remember when I watched it, I kept the message in mind. And I ended this with a thought-provoking speech, and maybe even making contradictory statements between self-improvement and self-destruction. But everything I said previously still holds on. You need the foundation of good mental health with simple habits, and you don't overcomplicate it. Just take the practical steps I gave you, all while keeping an eye on not doing the wrong things. I remember going through confusing times where I would hear something and another thing that seems as valuable, but they're totally contradictory. You're too young to understand what's good from bad. That is why you need to just take action on the very first thing you learn. And I hope this guide does justice to your life. Thank you for watching the video, and I truly wish you understand what I said and do take action. I'll make more simple videos explaining self-improvement and why I fully understand how to dissolve your old roots. I will share my experience and knowledge here on YouTube by making a no-bullshit guide. I wish you a good day and see you on the next one. Goodbye.